Hello friends, in this lecture we will see some more transformations. Okay, so transformations which are carried one after the other, so in short they are called as composite transformations. We will try to understand how the transformations can be carried out one after the other, what should be the sequence and in what order they should be multiplied in order to get the correct position of the object. So let's get started. We have already seen with matrix representations, okay, in the previous sections where we understood the basic transformations, which are translation, rotation and scaling. Okay, how an object can be translated, how the object can be rotated and how the object can be scaled, okay, if we know the parameters, okay, that we have already seen, and we have also set up the different matrices, okay, for the translation matrix we had set up, then we had set up a rotation matrix, and we had also set up the scaling matrix using the homogeneous coordinate system, okay, using the homogeneous coordinates. So the question is, if I have, let's say, a translation happening and after that I am trying to rotate the object, and then after that I am trying to scale the object and again trying to rotate the object. Okay, if I have successive transformations following the other transformation, in what sort of sequence I should consider them and in what sequence I should multiply them. Okay, that is the main question over here. So sequence of transformations as a composite transformation matrix by calculating the matrix product. So the question over here is, okay, when I am trying to multiply different matrices, okay, forming the transformation matrix, okay, the method is called as composite transformations, and the successive multiplication of such matrices is called as concatenation. Okay, it's called as concatenation. So the definition rightly says in the second line, that is, forming products of transformation matrices is often referred to as concatenation or composition of matrices. Okay, for a column matrix representation of coordinate positions, we form composite transformations by multiplying matrices in order from right to left. So that is very important. What we do all the time is, we have an object matrix which we need to transform. So the object matrix should be written on the extreme right hand side and followed by the sequence in which the further transformations needs to be carried. Okay, those transformation matrices should be multiplied to the left of the object matrix. So the last transformation would be the leftmost matrix, and I have on the rightmost side the object matrix. This is very, very important, because if I change the order, okay, then the matrix multiplication will change. So I need to understand the matrix multiplication law of associativity law and the pre-multiplication is an essential condition. Okay, so when we are representing the matrix in a column matrix manner, so the every new operation on the matrix, the object matrix, I will have to pre-multiply the existing matrix. So I will always remember, each successive transformation matrix pre-multiplies the product of the preceding transformation matrices. So let's take an example of translation. So if I have two successive translation vectors, that is tx1 ty1, tx2 ty2, okay, to be applied to a coordinate position p, then as you can see over here, the final transformed location p dash, okay, is, I have p multiplied, p is an object matrix that is getting pre-multiplied by the first translation vectors, that is tx1 ty1. So I have this first translation transformation, and that is further pre-multiplied by the second translation vector matrix, or that is translation matrix, that is Tx2 Ty2. So the sequence of matrix multiplication, I have on the rightmost side P, pre-multiplied to it I have the first translation matrix, and pre-multiplied to it on the left hand side I have the second translation matrix. So the sequence is very important, and as rightly it has been written over here. Okay, so this is my first translation matrix, 1 0 tx1 0 1 ty1 0 0 1, and it is being pre-multiplied by the second translation matrix, that is 1 0 tx2 0 1 ty2 0 0 1. Now what I have written over here is a multiplication of these two matrices. So if you have a successive translation to be carried out on an object matrix, you can directly consider this matrix, or I would always urge to follow the procedure. So the procedure is very simple: object matrix, keep it on the rightmost side, and in sequence keep on pre-multiplying. Okay? In sequence keep on pre-multiplying. Same is the case with rotation. So if you have two successive rotations applied to a point P, produce the transformed position. So P dash is going to be the transformed position of point P. So I have point P, so you can consider P as an object matrix as well. So you have object matrix onto the rightmost side, then you have the first rotation matrix with the help of theta 1, that is the first angle given, and then pre-multiplied to it you have the second rotation matrix with the help of theta 2. So you have two successive rotation matrices, okay, pre-multiplied one after the other. Now the good part about rotation, that is successive rotation, is, okay, we had seen already successive rotation, what happens by multiplying the two rotation matrices, we can verify that two successive rotations are additive. Okay, that was not the condition in case of translation, because it depends on the values and sign of those translation parameters. Okay, so if the signs are positive, negative, then we are not sure whether the things will get added or things will get subtracted or they will get multiplied. So we have to perform the matrix multiplication in sequence. But as far as rotation is concerned, even if the signs are opposite, still we know that the successive rotations are always additive in nature. Okay, so you can add those two angles, find out the resultant angle, and perform only one rotation, that is also sufficient if it is a question of two successive rotations, okay, applied. So that is what is written on the third line, so that the final rotated coordinates can be calculated with the composite rotation matrix as P dash equal to R of theta 1 plus theta 2. So what I can do, I can find out the answer of theta 1 plus theta 2. Maybe let's say theta 1 is 30 degrees, theta 2 is 40 degrees. I will find out theta 1 plus theta 2, that is 30 plus 40 equal to 70 degrees, and I will only write a rotation matrix for 70 degrees. Okay, so that will be cos 70 minus sin 70, 0, sin 70, cos 70, 0, and 0, 0, 1. So that is also sufficient. Okay, that is also sufficient. Let's see the third matrix, that is successive scaling. So concatenating transformation matrices for two successive scaling operations produces the following operations, okay, produces the following composite scaling matrix. So again, as we have seen in the previous two examples, okay, I have the first scaling matrix wherein I have been given scaling factor in x, scaling factor in y, so sx1 0 0 0 sy1 0 0 0 1, and it is getting pre-multiplied by the second scaling which requires to be performed. So again the two scaling factors are given, that is sx2 0 0 0 sy2 and 0 0 1. When I perform this matrix multiplication, eventually I get this sx1 multiplied by sx2 0 0 0 sy1 multiplied by sy2 0 0 0 1, or in other words, okay, it is the scaling factor or the scaling matrix comprising of the new set of scaling factors, that is sx1 multiplied by sx2, okay, and sy1 multiplied by sy2. So two successive scaling operations are multiplicative in nature. Okay, so the resulting matrix is in this case indicates that successive scaling operations are multiplicative. That is, if we were to triple the size of an object twice in succession, the final size would be 9 times that of the original. Okay, so if I have Sx1, Sy1 as 3 each and Sx2, Sy2, 3 each, then what is going to be the final scaling? Final scaling is going to be Sx1 multiplied by Sx2, that is 3 multiplied by 3, 9. Similarly, Sy1 multiplied by Sy2, that is 3 multiplied by 3, 9. So, the final scaling matrix would be of the order 900, 090, 001. So, I hope this has cleared some things. Okay, and just to have few examples coming into picture, okay, we will see some of the steps wherein we try to rotate the object with some other reference. Okay, we had already seen the rotation matrix is written for a coordinate reference. So if I have to rotate the object by 30 degrees, it will be always rotated about the 2D Cartesian coordinates origin. Okay, and if I have to rotate the object about some other reference, then I will have to first translate that other reference to origin, perform the rotation, and again translate the object back to its original position. So that is what we are going to do. If I have to rotate by some other reference, so general pivot point rotation. So in this particular triangle, the triangle needs to be rotated about this point x comma y or x1 comma y1. Okay, so directly I cannot rotate this triangle with this reference because the rotation always happens about origin. So what I will do, the sequence of operation is I will first bring this point to origin. So this is the back translation, we call it. So translate the object so that the pivot point position is moved to the coordinate origin, we call it back translate the object, because the translation is going to happen in a negative direction. So I will have to use translation coordinates as tx1 is equal to minus x1, ty1 equal to minus y1. Then this pivot point will become 0, 0. Okay, then I will rotate the object about the coordinate origin. So the rotation happened, and then again I will translate the reference pivot point back to the original position. So first I have to back translate by the given coordinates, okay, so that the reference becomes 0, 0. Then I will rotate the object about the coordinate origin, and then I will translate it the pivot point to its original position. So I will have three matrices to multiply the object matrix. So on the rightmost side I will have the object matrix, pre-multiplied to it the back translation matrix, pre-multiplied to it the rotation matrix, pre-multiplied to it the translation matrix. Okay, so something of this kind. Okay, so this is the back translation that happens. So 1 0 minus xr, 0 1 minus yr, 0 0 1. Okay, pre-multiplied to it the rotation matrix, so cos theta minus sin theta 0, sin theta cos theta 0, 0 0 1, and pre-multiplied to it the translation matrix. So this matrix will translate the object back to the original position. So it has 1 0 xr, 0 1 yr, 0 0 1. You can multiply, find the answer, and on the rightmost side you will be having the object matrix. Okay, on the rightmost side you will be having the object matrix. So this is in a equation form it is expressed. Similar to it, the scaling also generally happens about the origin. Okay, scaling also happens about the origin. If you have to change the reference from origin to some other point, then again similar steps you will have to follow. You will have to first bring that reference point to the origin, perform the scaling, and again bring that point back to the original position. So translate the object so that the fixed point coincides with the coordinate origin, scale the object with respect to the coordinate origin, and use the inverse translation of step 1 to return the object to its original position. So this is the back translation matrix, similar to what we had seen earlier in the rotation example. So 1 0 minus xf, 0 1 minus yf, 0 0 1. Then you have the normal scaling matrix, sx 0 0 0 sy 0 0 0 1, and then you have the forward translation or normal translation matrix, that is 10xf, 01yf and 001. So in equation form it is expressed in this way. You can find the answer in this way, or on to the right hand side you can have the object matrix getting multiplied, and then you can keep on multiplying in sequence. Okay, keep on multiplying in sequence. So we had so far seen the concatenations, we have so far seen how the successive translations, successive rotations, successive scalings needs to be performed. We have also seen if I have to rotate about some other reference, okay, how that is performed. So having followed these procedures, we are actually trying to learn the concatenations or the composite transformations. So I hope you have understood. And this is the scaling example with the pictorial representation. So scaling needs to be performed about this xf, yf, okay, and I make this as origin first. So I back translate this to origin, then I perform the scaling factor. Now the scaling factors are less than 1, so that is the reason why the size of the triangle is reducing. And then again I forward translate it to the original position. So this is the general fixed point scaling. Okay, general fixed point scaling. And earlier to this we had seen a general pivot point rotation. Okay, so I hope you have understood. We will see more such examples in the coming lectures. Thank you.